Hi, welcome to another Sonic Labs review. My name's Tosh from Widge Productions, and today we're going to be looking at the UAD emulation plugin of the Thermionic Culture Vulture. This is available for all users of Universal Audio's UAD2 hardware systems, so that includes the Apollo interface, the satellite, and the PCI card accelerators. To those of you not familiar with the name Thermionic Culture, this is a small British outfit specializing in high-end valve-based studio outboard gear. The Vulture is fairly unique as outboard equipment goes. It's an all-valve distortion and sonic enhancement unit. To quote Thermionic Culture, it's designed to produce the finest distortion money can buy. Quite a claim. In order to emulate this, Universal Audio have had to painstakingly go in and model the entire circuit chain, including the three valve stages that go into producing the sound from the system. So the first of those stages is obviously the input stage. Then there's a second stage, which is the dedicated distortion stage, and that uses a 6AS6 valve, which can be configured via a selector on the front panel to be literally wired into the circuit in a variety of different ways to provide different distortion characters. And finally, there's an output stage. The unit Universal Audio have chosen to implement in software is the standard Vulture. I've got an instance of it here on screen. Just pull that up now. I'm running this incidentally on my Apollo quad system, which is running off an i7 Mac Mini. As is the trend these days, you've got a beautifully rendered UI, which is pretty much identical to the hardware, apart from any additional features that you don't get in the hardware. In this case, we've got a control link switch and a mix blend dial, which I'll come onto in a minute. A quick outline of the controls. What we've got here are your drive, which is essentially your input gain. We've also got an overdrive switch here, which allows you to boost that input gain by a substantial amount. The next control is this bias knob. Now this controls the bias current going into that second stage, that 6AS6 valve. So it's really having a strong effect on the character of the distortion. This selector, three position selector, is the configuration for that valve. So we've got triode mode, pentode 1 and pentode 2. Triode is a kind of subtle warming distortion. P1's a bit more aggressive and P2's just a bit mental. Down here, you've got a low-pass filter, which is pretty useful for taming any of those overtones and top-end harmonics that you're bringing out with all that distortion. The output stage level control, bypass switch, and then the software-only features, like I mentioned, the link, and the mix blend, which means you can blend the wet and dry signal, which gives you a lot of flexibility to the kind of tones that you can achieve with this. Also of note is this big meter here. Now this isn't a level meter as you'd expect it to be. This is actually showing the bias current flowing in that second stage valve. So it's not totally obvious what this does. But as you get to use the plugin, you get a feel for it a bit more. It kind of shows how hard that stage is working, how much the kind of distortion you're going to be getting. Again, it's one of those things as we go through some examples, we can have a look at and see how it responds. What I quite like to do is to pass a test signal through this, have a look on the scope and see what it's doing to that signal. So if we start off with your basic sine wave, you can see there we've got a peak at 1 kHz. Now, this plugin is all about harmonic distortion. So that's adding harmonics at multiples of that frequency. So if I put it into its basic triode mode and blend in the distortion, here we see the first harmonic building up. As I mix in all that distortion, we can see a nice series of peaks. If I turn up the gain, or the drive, as we'd expect, we're getting more and more distortion. You can hear it as well in that sine wave has now become a bit more squarish, probably. Now notice as I turn up the distortion, the drive, the balance of those harmonics doesn't just keep increasing, they change. So we've got quite non-linear behavior here. And when we get to extreme levels, we're starting to see a different balance of harmonics. So the different distortion types that triode, pentode 1, pentode 2 favor a different balance of harmonics. If I switch to pentode,
you can see another range of harmonics there. And if I go to pentode 2, we get a very different set of harmonics. And what's interesting here is that this first harmonic is dominating the fundamental. And what that means in reality is you can get a sort of pitch doubling. It's going to give you an octave up on your original sound, which you can hear in the sine wave. If I blend it out. Now, it's all well and good listening to a sine wave, but it'd be quite nice to hear some musical examples. So that's what we're going to do now. So for my first example, I've got a session here in Logic Pro X. This is a bit of production I've been working on recently. A great project coming out of Bristol. This is a guy called Greg Cordes and his band Paper Cranes, a modern jazz quintet. If I just zoom in there on the Vulture. The obvious starting place for something like this would be a drum track. Lends itself perfectly to a bit of distortion. The idea with this tune was we got a lovely clean recording, which was done over at Fieldgate Studios in Cardiff. We wanted to put a bit of dirt on the overall sound, so I'll just kick that off. That's the fabulous Mr. Mark Whitlam there, laying down 5-4, 10-8, I'm not really sure how you count it. Beat, I don't know what's wrong with 4-4 these days. So you can hear, quite a nice track, quite clean. Let's start dirtying it up. We start in triad mode, and I'll blend in the distortion. Level balance there. So, let's see. So, let's crank the drive. And you can hear it starting to crunch up. Bring that level down. Hear it on that kick and that crunchy snare. Let's try playing with the bias. Turning the bias current down actually increases the bias current, conversely. You can see it on the meter that it's actually going this way. What that's doing is overfeeding, if you like, that valve. And the sonic effect is a fattening, thickening of the sound, which you can hear. If I go the other way, you're starving the valve. So undercurrent, and you're coming this way. And what you tend to get is almost a gate-like effect where only the transients are poking through. It's quite an extreme sound there. Now again, having this blend control is great because it means you can set something up pretty full on and just dial in a little bit. We compare it with it off. There we go on. Let's go back to try out some of the other modes. This is pentode 2. Now this is a more aggressive distortion. Bring that level down. Turn the drive up. Yeah, you can hear it on that kick and those toms. That's a nice distortion. We work with the bias again. Starving it. Put that level up. Or go fat. That's quite heavy. What's nice as well is we've got the low pass filter. If you want to take some of the top end off, go quite lo-fi. Easily done. Now you can already see we've got quite a range of sounds coming out there. Let's see. Turn the drive back, put the overdrive on. Now we're getting into real extreme territory. Let's blend that in. And then finally, let's have a look at pentode 2 mode. This is the crazy distortion setting. Already you can see it's almost gating my sound there. Let's get a bit more level. Drive it harder. Bring the current down. See how it's crunched that cymbal up? Nasty. Now if we filter that, maybe blend it in a bit. Okay, so that's what it sounds like on drums. How about on a bit of bass? So here's the bass line. Let's blend in that distortion. So triad mode, again pretty subtle. Now you can start hearing it fuzz up a bit. See how the character changes with bias. Thinned out. Fattened. Let's put the filter on. Let's try the Pentode 1. Again, with these extreme settings, I can blend them in. Like so. And finally, let's see what the Pentode 2 mode sounds like. Ah, that's quite nasty. I like that. Blend it in. Just to add a bit of bite. Maybe use a filter. Overdrive. And then we're into the realms of squashed. You can also hear the compression effect that you're getting out of this as well, as you distort harder. In this track, we've also got some piano. So let's see what that sounds like if we dirty it up. So we start with a nice clean sound. Let's bring in some distortion there. Again, that's quite subtle. Well, it's starting to break up there. I play with the bias, you can hear the variation on the tone. Quite heavy. Let's go to Pentode 1. And if I play that from the beginning again, and go to Pentode 2. Now, I don't know if you can hear that there, but that frequency doubling I was talking about, you can hear that on there. It's like an extra octave up on that piano line. Without. With. Obviously, this is pretty extreme. But you can get some really interesting textures out of this.
Okay, so for my next example, I'm going to play you a bit of a production I've been working on for a group called Ahipati. Again, another Bristol-based outfit who are a Latin band featuring musicians from Colombia and Cuba, and it's a bit more of a rootsy sound. So our first example is using it to colour the sound of the horns. The horn section here, I'll just play it. Incidentally, this is all one person layering up the horn sounds. You've got trumpet and valve trombone in there. Quite a nice fat sound. Just bringing in a nice bit of subtle distortion using the Triad 1 mode. Drive that a bit harder. You can hear that breaking up quite a lot. And if you want us to go more extreme, that's quite aggressive. Again, if you play with the bias, quite heavy, quite thin. Now, some of these sounds you probably wouldn't want to use in isolation. You might want to blend them. Dry, wet. Let's see what the other distortion flavours do to that sound. Pentode 1. Again, let's go for fully wet. Now, that's quite heavy. Again, bias current. And Pentode 2. Now that's quite extreme. You might want to use that in a special effect. Or you might want to blend it. And you can hear there. Subtle, but definite change of character of the horn sound. So here's an example of how it sounds on vocals. Here we've got a bit of a rap from Indira Roman. Putting that up for you. So this is the dry sound. If I now go fully wet, bring that level up. And drive that. So dry, level balance,
dry, wet. Giving a bit more body, a bit more depth. See what happens if we go to P1. Apart from a level change. So dry, wet. You can hear a bit of breaking up there. A bit more aggressive sound to it. And what it might be nice to do is dry that. And then blend it. So go there. So let's have a listen to that. Try. Yo que te he brindado lo mejor que puedo dar y todito mi corazón. Qué situación y te la diste. We're going to hear again a nice change of color that we can use in the mix. Yo que te he brindado. So here we have the full mix. Let's put that playing. We've got the Vulture fully bypassed now. Balance those controls. We go fully wet. Quite a muffled sound. Bring the level up there. That's with it in. Let's push the drive up a bit more. Now, this is something where the meters can be useful. Because if you set the bias current to around 0.4, you can get a sort of tape saturation type sound, which you can then blend in with the original mix. That's without. That's with. Again, if we go for something a bit more heavy, blend that in. Again, getting this level balancing just right. Out. In. Adding a warmth and slight crunchiness to the overall sound. So you've seen how the Vulture can perform on individual elements in the mix and on the entire mix as well. There's another application I'd quite like to show you, which is more of a sound design approach to using the Vulture. In this example, I've got just a classic 808 type drum machine and a synth patch set up. And I've got the Vulture set up on both of those channels. So let's have a look at the drum machine first. Simple beat, nothing special there. Just come in close so you can see what I'm doing. Now, as you'd expect with a drum machine, distortion lends itself very well to beefing that sound up. Here in triad mode. There you can hear, that's nice, crunching it. Play with the bias. Now if we go into pentode, see you hear what starts happening is that if you've got any harmonic content in your drum pattern, like those tuned toms or kick, they start to take on a new character, a new life, and almost becoming part of the bass line. And let's go into pentode 2. You definitely hear it there, very synthy kind of sound. And if we go to a patch that has a bit more of that kind of sound in it. There we go. Now we start really mangling. What if we go into overdrive? We're seeing some pretty extreme sound shaping going on. Let's use the filter. So if we can go back to what our original sound was, This is what we started with. And this is where we are now. So if you're into your mangled sounding electronica, this is actually a very good tool for coming up with some new interesting sounds. Now, if we go back out and have a look at the synth example, what I've got here is the analog synth in Ableton. I've got an arpeggiator running into it. So an interesting thing here is that I'm using one of the Max for Live plugins, the LFO, which you can map an LFO to any parameter in Live. Here I've got it mapped to the gates of the arpeggiator, so I can get a nice variation to the arpeggiator duration. Again, bring some different kind of movement into your sounds. So we got a fairly simple sinusoidal synth coming out of analog, going into the Vulture. Now what I've done here is to exploit the fact that the Vulture is two channel and normally we're using that in stereo, what you can do is put a mid-side encoder and decoder either side of it, and that means you can use one channel for processing your mid signal and the other channel for processing your side signal. What this means is you can do some nice stereo expansion effects with this by setting up subtly different distortions on the mid and the side channels. So if we come into there in detail, if I switch the controller over. So I'm now controlling the mid channel. If I take the volume right down and turn the volume up on the side channel, we should be able to hear the difference in the stereo signal. If I blend out, that's the original signal. And then if I change the kind of distortion, balance of each signal, a bit more of the mids. Obviously, it will help if you're listening to this in stereo, so you can get an idea for how this is working. Take it out. Just throwing that stereo image out a bit more and making the sound a bit more interesting. Run a lower pattern. So generating bass type sounds. Let's see what kind of noises we can make. Using the filter there. This is what we're starting with. This is where we are now. Play with the bias. So you're almost like filtering here. Let's go back to that heavier sound. Again, fatter sound with lower bias. Very heavy drive. Back to triad mode. And then of course, let's spread it by changing the side signal. There we go. So from that simple sound, there's something like that, which is a lot more exciting. You might notice I've been using a MIDI controller to work the plugin parameters. This makes workflow generally a lot easier than getting there with a mouse and trying to bounce around. I'm sure as many of you know. This runs through the door. Unfortunately, this isn't something that you can do if you are running this plugin on board the Apollo for live tracking. There still is no MIDI control interface to the Apollo for that purpose, which is a shame, but hopefully something that they might address in the future. Well, if we look at the pros and cons, on the pros side, I hope what I've managed to convey there that this is a very versatile plugin. And beyond that, it's actually quite fun to play with, especially when you've got it set up with a controller like that. On the negative side, this is a very processor-intensive plugin. To give you an example, if I pull up console here, so this is the UAD front end for the Apollo, and I've got the DSP meter down here telling you how much of the DSP resources we're using. So this is running on an Apollo quad. That's a four processor system. If I stick in an example of the Vulture, an instance of the Vulture, see we've gone up to 22%. But as far as being DSP intensive goes, that's actually fine by me because I want, that's the whole point of having the UAD2 system, that you can run these heavy duty plugins that would cripple your computer. So I don't really see that as a major drawback, especially given that UA are now releasing satellite Octo models. So you're gonna have plenty of processing power. So another downside of sorts would be the cost. These aren't cheap plugins. This one's retailing at $299, so that's about 200 quid. But then if you think about it, the actual hardware Vulture is a grand a pop, and if you're getting pretty close to the sound for a fifth of the price, that's not too bad, especially seeing as you can have several instances of it. Also worth noting is it's coming up to December and there's usually a UA sale, so you might be able to pick up a bargain. So to summarise, the Universal Audio plugin emulation of the Thermionic Culture Vulture, that's available now to all UAD2 hardware system owners. An incredibly versatile plugin, going anywhere from the very subtle sonic enhancement of a track to full-on mangling and sound shaping that you can use with a variety of sources. So taking all of that into consideration, another powerful, versatile, and ultimately very useful sonic tool from Universal Audio. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one. Thank you.